As Spanish colonizers walked across the Peru desert in the 1500s, they stumbled across some peculiar ruts in the ground. These dugout lines extended for kilometers in seemingly random directions. At the time, the Spanish thought the grooves were roads made by an ancient civilization. No one really understood the magnitude or mystery of the lines for hundreds of years. It wasn't until the 1920s, when a Peruvian archaeologist happened to glance down a hillside, that the full picture came into view. The lines formed massive, glorious drawings. There was a monkey more than 100 meters long, a hummingbird that stretched its wings for more than 50 meters, and an array of geometric spirals and other shapes. These drawings came to be known as the Nazca Lines, and they've puzzled archaeologists ever since. There have been countless theories about what they mean and why they were created. So today, let's take a historical walk in the desert, from the lines' discovery to the modern research that's helping us interpret them, and all that we still don't know. If you want to explore the Nazca Lines, you'll have to venture to an area called the Pampa, an arid plain about 400 kilometers south of Lima. It's here, in an area spanning more than 450 square kilometers, that the Nazca Lines take shape. They're a type of landscape art called geoglyphs, and they're stunningly diverse. Some depict things in the natural world, like birds, people, plants, or insects, while others are spirals, zigzags, and wiggles. Recent dating of artifacts found on or near the lines puts them around 2,000 years old. It's amazing that these etchings have stuck around all that time, given that they're literally just lines carved into the dirt. See, the soil in the arid pampas has multiple layers, and if you carve away the reddish iron oxide-filled top layer, you'll reveal a white lime and clay layer underneath. That's all these lines are, and they've lasted for centuries. Partly that's thanks to the dry climate and the wind that sweeps sand out of the grooves, but also the area is now a protected UNESCO heritage site, and there are good reasons to protect it. The Nazca Lines bring up so many questions, like, who made them? How do you even create something this big? And why? The first time the lines were studied scientifically was in 1927 by a Peruvian archaeologist named Toribio Mejia Hespe. Hespe mapped the geoglyphs and studied other structures along the lines too. He discovered cemeteries which resembled those from the Nazca people, who lived between 200 BCE and 600 CE. Hespe concluded that they made the lines as paths for religious ceremonies, or maybe even as aqueducts. But the Nazca people never left a written record, so he couldn't be certain, and his aqueduct theory became the first of many. With the advent of airplanes in the 1940s, interest in the lines grew. Suddenly, people could view the art from above and marvel at its sheer size and precise shapes. One of the biggest Nazca line enthusiasts and researchers was Maria Reihe, a German Peruvian mathematician who later became known as the Lady of the Lines. She took over the work of scholar Paul Kosok, who was interested in irrigation and wanted to see if Hespe's aqueduct theory held. When Reihe traveled to the desert with Kosok in 1946, she became obsessed. She lived in a small hut in the desert and clean the lines and shoot away people who might disturb them. That obsession yielded a bunch of new information about the lines, including theories of how these ancient figures were made. One key thing that she discovered was that these images weren't free-handed drawings. She and other archaeologists found wooden stakes at the end of the lines, which made them think that the carvers would stick the stakes into the ground and run a cord between them, basically making a ruler that they could trace along. And of course, Reihe came up with her own ideas of what the lines were for. While walking along the lines one day, her former boss, Kosok, had noticed that one line pointed directly at the setting sun, and he thought, huh, maybe this is a marker for the winter solstice. Shortly after, Reihe discovered another line that pointed at where the sun would be on the summer solstice, and together they decided that the Nazca lines formed an elaborate celestial calendar. While the straight lines pointed to times of the year, the images could have represented constellations, except many of the lines didn't point to anything significant in the night sky. And a theory that only holds for some of the geoglyphs and not others isn't much of a theory. That meant by the 90s, Reihe's astronomy theory had fallen out of favor with archaeologists. But before I tell you more about the ideas that replaced it, an ad.
Thanks to Incogni for supporting this SciShow video. Incogni's mission is to help you avoid cybercrime and personal privacy breaches. Of all the things to worry about in this day and age, Incogni wants to take cybersecurity off your list. Here's the problem a lot of people are facing today. Data brokers can collect and sell your personal information, like really important stuff from social security numbers to login credentials. But Incogni steps in to request that they remove your personal data. They offer what so many of us dream of, to take your worries and fears away. Their services are fully automated, so everything just gets taken care of. No muss, no fuss. But if you like to be more proactive, Incogni also offers a progress tracker for you to watch the whole thing as it happens. It's like watching your food get prepared and sent out for delivery, but instead of a meal that is gone in a matter of minutes, Incogni can protect you for years. You can try it for 30 days and get a full refund if you aren't happy with the service. To take your personal data back and get 60% off an annual Incogni plan, use the code SciShow at incogni.com/SciShow or click the link in the description.
New theories from the 2000s onwards instead focused on religious or cultural interpretations. They started thinking about where the lines were carved, aka the valley floor, making them best viewed from above. But people living 2000 years ago didn't have airplanes to view the lines, so why make them best visible from so high up? Maybe, archaeologists argued, it was to be viewed by the gods as a form of religious devotion. Problem is, the ground isn't the only place these images have been found. Some have been carved into the hillsides. When archaeologists started studying the hillside geoglyphs, they saw that the images resembled pottery and textiles from another, even older culture called the Paracas, who lived here from 700 BCE to 1 CE. Which means that not all of the Nazca lines are made by Nazca people, and the Paracas were geoglyphing before it was cool. And because the images were on the walls of the valley, researchers thought they were meant to convey important cultural concepts to other people, so kind of like an early form of billboards. And there's one image that shows up time and time again. Birds, which made archaeologists wonder what kind of birds they were and why the Nazca carved them so often. In 2019, ornithologists and archaeologists teamed up to identify the birds. Weirdly, many of the species weren't local to the desert at all. There were pelicans, parrots, and hermit hummingbirds. Scientists thought that maybe the pelican was a symbol for rain, since migrating seabirds were believed to be a sign that rain was coming and that there'd be a good harvest. Parrots probably lived in the nearby jungle, and they were kept as pets. And maybe the Nazca just thought all these birds were really cool. No, really. Birds also show up in Nazca pottery, and archaeologists have found bird remains, like feathers, at ceremonial sites next to the geoglyphs. So birds held some kind of special significance, but their exact role is still unclear. And in addition to teaming up with scientists from other fields, modern geoglyph researchers have also turned to technology to help them study the lines. One approach they've tried is GIS, or Geographic Information System. That's where you record lots of data points about things like where settlements are, topographic features, or even the Earth's curvature, and layer them on top of each other to study an area. Researchers thought that this approach might reveal some kind of pattern in the lines, or something about how the Nazca people viewed them. Their analysis found that roughly two-thirds of the geoglyphs were placed in a way that they were within sight of other geoglyphs, which made researchers think that any activity happening on one geoglyph, whether that was building it or something else like a ritual, was meant to be seen by other people working on or standing on another geoglyph. And much more recently, archaeologists have employed AI to help them in their studies. In 2024, the technology had helped researchers discover more than 300 new lines in the space of just 6 months. It took around a century to find the first 430 of them, so this was a big deal. Most of these new glyphs were much fainter and smaller than previous ones, and instead of being outlined like a picture, they were hollowed out reliefs. In the study, researchers flew a drone over the Nazca Pampa and took images of the ground. An AI tool then outlined potential geoglyphs, and a human confirmed them. They also mapped where these new images were, and saw that a lot of the figure geoglyphs were spread out and intersected with the geometric and line glyphs, which made them think that people walked along the lines in geometric shapes to view the more artistic outline style figures. Plus, these lines all seem to converge on a sacred temple and waterway, so maybe this network of lines and pictures served as a pilgrimage route for ancient civilizations. And the relief style geoglyphs were found close to many ancient walking trails, which again supports the idea that these images communicated something to people walking nearby. And those images usually depicted some kind of scene, like people with livestock or human sacrifice, so they could have been conveying information about agriculture or religion. Now, pretty much all the studies we've talked about so far have assumed one major thing, that the Nazca lines on the ground have to be viewed from above. But one research team disagrees. They spent more than 150 days walking 1,500 kilometers of Nazca lines. They focused on a series of lines they call the labyrinth, which makes a long, winding path across the Pampa, only to return to where the walker started. It's still in excellent condition, like it had been very well taken care of. It's also narrow, with sharp turns and twists, meaning that if people walked it, they probably walked slowly and in single file. All of which made researchers think the line could have been part of a ceremony, maybe even religious, and maybe not even made to be walked by people at all, but by gods. But even the authors note, this is all just speculation at this point, and there are so many other theories we haven't mentioned. That's the difficult and fascinating thing about the Nazca Lines. Without written records, it's really hard to know what they all mean and what significance they held. But archaeologists are convinced they are significant and tell us about what life was like in Nazca society, which is why people are now protecting the lines from damage by vandals. The great preservation work that started with Maria Raihe continues to this day. Thanks to them, maybe someday we'll have a clearer view of these ancient mysteries.